great to see you.
I will be. In the interest of getting going as fast as we can, I know that Governor Deal just sat down, and I don't think he needs a long introduction, so I'm going to ask him to come back up. He's going to talk for a while, Governor Deal, and you know, on a topic that he is passionate about and certainly has accomplished a lot about. So without further ado, Governor Nathan Deal.
Thank you very much, Kevin. Thanks to all of you for being here today, and there's nothing much worse than a has-been, and I feel in that category, I'm afraid. But I want to thank, first of all, I want to thank Kerry Miller for inviting me and for what he and Chief Justice Michael Boggs have done with regard to the criminal justice issues, and they have done great work. And if you really want an expert, you just need to ask the Chief Justice of our Supreme Court. He's the one who really was the leader in the reform over the eight years, considering the first year when we organized the Criminal Justice Reform Council. Let me try to be as brief as I can. You probably have heard enough statistics, but I want to give you just a little bit of a feel for why criminal justice reform actually was undertaken in 2011. At that time, we had a population in our prison system of about 56,000, and it had doubled between 1990 and 2011. The prison population had doubled, and it had in fact increased 35% between 2000 and 2011, 35% increase in that relatively short period of time. We had the fourth highest rate of adults in prison of any state in the country, and we were only the eighth largest population, but the fourth largest prison population at that time. Our prisons were overcrowded at about 107% capacity. And as a result of that, even though we were spending $1.1 billion to the Department of Corrections, we still had that overcapacity. Now, one of the things that is amazing that you can really understand quickly is that when I was on the campaign trail in 2010, and I would talk to sheriffs, the first thing they would say is, "When are you going to get all these state prisoners out of my local jail?" Because in that year, we were paying some $25 million to local sheriffs to keep prisoners who had already gotten sentenced to a state sentence, but to keep them in their local jail because we didn't have room for them in our prisons. We were told we're going to have to build two new adult prisons within the first 4 years, that first term that I had, and things didn't look particularly well. Now, there are a lot of talking points that were used by me and perhaps a few of the others here on this platform today as we were trying to convince the public that this effort to reform our prison system or our criminal justice system was important. One that I used and always got some heads turning, and that is that one out of every 13 Georgians was under some form of correctional supervision. Now, if you go to the local Kiwanis Club or the Rotary Club and you say that, and they're a little bit shocked when they hear it, and the next reaction they have is they start looking around the room trying to figure out, who is that one out of 13 that's sitting close to me? One of the reasons we had such a high population that was in that category of being under some kind of supervision was that we had an excessively large number of people who were given probation. They may have probation on the front end, but they also may have probation on the tail end after they have served whatever criminal sentence they had been sentenced to by the judge, but they had probation tacked on the end of it. And that really was one of the primary things, I think, that caused us to have such a high percentage of people in that category of being under some kind of supervision. Well, today, and I know the General Assembly being in session and the Governor and others have talked about the problem of criminal justice issues that are facing our state today. We have certainly, and I understand the reasons, and I am sympathetic and hope that the General Assembly will devise some answers that will be satisfying to the public and will help solve the problem that we're facing today. But I want you to understand the distinction. As much as some would try to say that what we did is now being undone by the General Assembly and by the Governor today, that is totally incorrect. We were concentrating our efforts on those that we classified as nonviolent of individuals. And 25% of those who were going into our prison system were being classified as nonviolent, and yet they're going to a prison bed. That was cumulative on top of what had happened for several decades as the approach had been to get tough on crime. Longer sentences, mandatory minimums, and we had this huge amount of those who were in our prison system that were classified as nonviolent. Now you try to explain to the average voter why you're spending $20,000 to keep somebody that you say is classified as nonviolent in a prison bed. Didn't make a whole lot of sense. So after Barry Margaret and I and others sort of softened them up a little bit with those kind of rather staggering statistics, it made it easier to pass criminal justice reform. In fact, when I first announced it, that was an agenda item for my administration, I was told, "You're a Republican. That doesn't sound like a Republican issue. Why are you doing it?" I said, "Because it's the right thing to do." But with that mindset of the political separation as to where this issue stood, it was amazing with the work of members of the General Assembly and those of you, some of you in this audience were supportive of that and helping us to convince people that it was the right thing to do. The first year, we tackled adults who were nonviolent, and it meant really expanding the accountability court system, which was really very small at that time. I think we had only 33 drug courts in the entire state of Georgia at that time. And now I'm pleased to say we have accountability courts in every one of our judicial circuits, and I think there are 49 different judicial circuits. And they are of multiple types of courts. We started out with the drug courts, the DUI courts. They've expanded veterans courts, family courts, and more importantly now, I think, mental health courts. And that's, of course, the gist of what is going to be the focus of this panel discussion here today. And it's altogether appropriate that we do so. Now, what they're focusing on now, and I'm going to hit it quickly because I'm not an expert on this and not in a position to do anything about it. They're focusing on things like gang activity. And certainly I think all of us are concerned with that. We don't want to see any more young people siphoned off into gangs and therefore as being fodder for our prison system. They are focusing on the prosecution. We've had several DAs, I understand, in our state who publicly announced that they're not going to prosecute people for certain offenses in their particular circuit. Well, I understand that one of the ways they're going to propose to do that is to lower the percentage of the population that has to sign on to a recall petition. And as a former county attorney who went through a recall petition on my county commissioners, every one of them got recalled. It was not an easy task to even get that proposition before the public, but once it gets some steam behind it, it can really take off and go. But the threshold is being proposed to be lowered, and I think that is probably a very appropriate way of trying to resolve that problem. Before I get into a few other minor issues that I want to touch on, I want to congratulate you on the panel that you have here. You have one of the senior members of the State House and longtime friend of mine. She used to practice law in Gainesville, Georgia. In my circuit, you were a public defender at that time, or the equivalent of a public defender. I've known Mary Margaret for many, many years. And both of us have the white hair to prove it. So. But she's an expert, and I'm pleased to see her on the panel. And of course, the others will speak for themselves. My friend, the senator, and of course, the probably one of the most outstanding accountability court judges that we have here, Kerry Miller, as I've already referenced, who was my legal counsel for part of the years that we were undertaking these legislative reforms. And then Kevin Tapp, the new commissioner of the Department of DBHDD. And I first met Kevin when he was a deputy sheriff in Dawson County. And he is extremely well qualified for the position to which he's been appointed. And I think we're all gonna see that he's got proposals in his department that are gonna make a huge difference in dealing with these issues of mental problems. So, and it's certainly one that I think deserves to be addressed. But like anything, when you start either going in a new direction or expanding the direction you may have already started, in government, it takes resources, it takes personnel, it takes money to provide the kind of resources that are needed. And in the mental health arena, one of the things that we need is we need more doctors, more psychiatrists who are trained to deal with these very specific type of issues. We need more nurses to work with them. We need a lot of support personnel because it is a more intense, hands-on kind of problem that you'll be dealing with. Now, once again, I recall from the campaign days, when you talk to a sheriff, they would bring up the subject of mental health issues, even back some 12 years ago or so. And what they would say is, everybody in my jail has a mental health issue. And quite frankly, they were probably right. We had not given enough insight and thought as to what that really meant, because the types of mental issues that they had were varied, to say the least. Now, one of the areas I referred to earlier was in the accountability courts is the expansion of the mental health courts. And I think many of your circuits probably already have those courts in place, and they are doing an exceptional job. Like all accountability courts, they are intended to deal with specific, defined categories of offenders based on what their particular needs are. Veterans courts, obviously the name implies what that population group is. One of the good things about that one is that if they're veterans, they can tap into the VA healthcare system, and they have a lot more resources sometimes than we can provide at the state level, and those courts, I'm sure, are doing that. Now, my daughter drove me down today, and I am still shell-shocked from all the traffic that we had to go through coming down from Habersham County just to get here on time today. And the little GPS, it kept saying, well, it started out, we're gonna get here at 3:24. Then it got to be 3:48. Then it got to be 4:01, and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, reminded me of why I don't come here very often. This is the third time this week I've had to come down to Atlanta. So anyway, she told me, said, I told her what I was going to use as an analogy for you today. And she said, be careful how far you get with that analogy. So I love analogies because I think they're the way that you can talk about something without talking about it, because you can analogize similar situations. So I'm gonna give one that, Kevin, you've never heard this one before, I am sure. Have any of you, and I'm gonna ask for participation, show of hands, have any of you ever developed a piece of property, whether it be for your home, that required that you had to grade the lot off? Okay. Have any of you ever developed a piece of property for an office building or even like a subdivision where you had to have the property graded off? I've done the office building. Okay. Well, now, there are certain things you have to do if you start disturbing that land. One of the things you have to do is you have to have silt fences up so that water does not push the dirt to places that it doesn't want to be. You don't want it to be. This is an environmental issue by all definitions. And in addition to silt fences, if you've got a big enough graded off spot, you're going to have a holding pond, a collection pond. Water will flow down. Hopefully the silt fences are going to catch the silt and the dirt, and the water flows through this fabric that the silt fence is made of, and it proceeds on down, and then it collects into a holding pond. Now, my analogy is this. Those holding ponds are like our prisons. The silt fences are like our accountability courts. They're designed to try to keep the particles and the things that you don't want to fill up your prison system, and to try to keep them back and keep them in the general vicinity of where they are. My analogy appropriate?
Yes.
I think it may be. Now, I always worry about using analogies because I figure somebody in this group is going to say, oh, he's comparing people who get in trouble as dirt. No, I'm not doing that. And if you want to dispel your mind of that analogy, just remember the main thing that silt fences catch is the topsoil. Topsoil is the richest soil there generally is. So, what is happening in our criminal justice system sometimes is that we catch up some of the ones who really can be redeemed and can become very functioning members of our society. And that's why those courts are so critical, in my opinion, to meaningful and lasting criminal justice reform. So, not only did we not have to build those two new adult prisons, we actually saw our prison populations decline. And that was a very good thing. I'm not going to go into all of those statistics, but I can tell you that it saved our state a lot of money. It made things that were not thought of before available as we gave local judges and local counties the ability to use their imagination as to what suited their particular situation, and hopefully to keep and retain those citizens who otherwise might have wound up in that retention pond. Thank you very much for having me today. I appreciate the opportunity to be with you.
Thank you, Governor Deal, and thanks for the telling the story of really a brave initiative taken on by Governor of Georgia. So thank you for that. All right, well, what we're going to do next to get our panel going is Richard is going to queue up a video for us, I think. And I have great confidence that it will play because I had nothing to do with setting it up. Let's get it to play.
Thank you.